Hi, I'm Nick Gonzalez, and welcome to BPS Technology's monthly webinars. Tonight's episode, episode two, is Being Safe and Smart Online. Please join us via Workplace on our Zoom connection, and today we're going to be talking about internet safety with a webinar that's entitled Using Technology Safely, Responsibly, and Respectfully. My name is Nicholas Gonzalez, and I am accompanied by Rhiannon Gutierrez, Ed Considine, and Mark Pijanowski. We are using Zoom and are live on BPS Workplace right now. However, if you want to follow along with us, you can feel free to access these slides at bit.ly/DIGSAF webinar, DIGSAF short for digital safety. Before we jump into the meat of the topic, let's throw out this question out to all you viewers. Using the workplace comment feature, what experiences are you having in your classroom that have resonated with you in terms of digital citizenship and safety? For example, copying, cutting and pasting, cyberbullying. And again, what is digital safety if you think about it? You know, a lot of people just think of it as online behavior or online safety, and there's a lot more to it than just that. It's also using technology to make your community better. It's also engaging respectfully online and having good behavior online. It's using tech to make your voice heard by leaders and by the public. And it's also you also use it in order to determine the validity of some of the resources that you find online. This is a big one nowadays because of things like, for example, fake news. And I hear a lot of times teachers saying, oh, computers and robots are going to be taking our jobs. I think nothing could be further from the truth. We need teachers now more than ever to validate and to verify all the content that's out there, that, you know, this torrential amount of content that's available to all of our students. And so teachers are going to be the ones that have to say yay or nay when in terms of the usefulness of these resources. So again, digital citizenship encompasses all of this. Aside from these topics being very important, all the ones that we just discussed right now, there are actually hard standards in place already that actually address a lot of these topics. What we use for the most part is the 2016 Massachusetts DLCS curriculum framework and standards. DLCS stands for Digital Literacy and Computer Science curriculum framework. So there are standards in place already, and they're official. And if you'd like to go ahead and take a look at them, by all means, go ahead and click on the link. But it has a lot of really good resources and a lot of good strategies to approach computer science and digital literacy and digital citizenship within your classroom, especially digital citizenship, because it's embedded in almost every single grade level. And a lot of what's drawn from in terms of formulating the Massachusetts DLCS is a content used from computer science, CSTA K-12, which are computer science standards, and ISTE, which is the International Society for Technology and Education. And they're the gold standard in terms of technology and education. So these standards were formulated using some pretty good resources. So just to go through a couple, we don't want to get too bogged down in all the standards, and we know this slide is very text heavy, so we're not going to spend too much time here. We wanted to spare you through going through every single line, but we just wanted to point out some of the digital citizenship and safety standards that have been embedded into the Massachusetts Digital Literacy and Computer Science standards. So if you look at K through 12, the CAS Computing and Society section, you'll see safety and security is A, ethics and law B, and interpersonal and societal impact is C. You can look at the digital tools and collaboration piece as well. Digital A being digital tools, collaboration and communication, and research. So these two squares go hand in hand with each other because they essentially, one affects the other. And in order to do what's on the right side, you have to understand the left side really well. So it's not just something, it's not a, digital citizenship is just not something you can patch on to your current work. It's something that needs to start very early in order to get our students into the, you know, bring our students into contemporary learning and using technology within learning, because it has become such an integral part of education now. So digital citizenship and digital safety need to start at a very young age and a very low grade level. So you can see this is kindergarten through grade two, and just to show you how important it is, you can see all the places, and the arrows pointed out, all the places where digital citizenship is addressed within these grade two standards of the digital literacy and computer science standards. So if you look at the top one, care for devices, Second one, explain the password helps protect privacy of information. Identify safe and unsafe examples of online communication. All the way down to ethics and law, define good digital citizenship as using technology safely, responsibly, and ethically. You know, and even to the last one, explain the importance of giving credit to media creators, owners when using their work. So again, this is something that starts at a very low, at younger grade levels and at younger ages. And again, this is something that's going to be continued on throughout the students progressing through their grade levels all the way to high school. We gave you the importance of digital citizenship. Now we want to give you some really good resources that are out there and that are free. We have Common Sense Media, which is another gold standard in technology and education. Their digital citizenship curriculum is very, very robust and very sophisticated. And it is used widely throughout school districts and colleges throughout the country and world, actually. So the digital citizenship section and within Common Sense Media and Common Sense Education, again, is a very useful tool. And then we also have Google's Be Internet Awesome, which is a newer curriculum that's used by BPS and endorsed by BPS technology. And it's the curriculum is very, very interesting, very engaging in that it relies a lot on a game. So side by side, you see here Common Sense Education, their digital citizenship and safety curriculum, and Google's Be Internet Awesome curriculum. So side by side, you can see what grades they apply to and who can who uses it. So grades 3 through 6, ages 8 through 12, for Be Internet Awesome. You also have on Common Sense Education, you have K through 2, 3 to 5, 6 through 8, and 9 through 12. You have the format, lessons, online game, Interland, online games, digital passport for Common Sense Education. You have, it's about 1 hour for Be Internet Awesome, and it varies by grade span for Common Sense Education. The languages are also available, English and Spanish. PD is also available. 1 hour trainings are offered by both for free. Also, for Be Internet Awesome, you can integrate it into Google Classroom. While for Common Sense Education, you get a free account acquired to access lesson plans and material. And the URLs are both at the bottom. So you can see here is the curriculum for Be Internet Awesome. And again, you can integrate this into Google Classroom if you like. And here is Common Sense Media. And you can see that there's the grade bands, there are the units. And again, it's really useful and very self-explanatory. Again, Common Sense Media and Google are two very, very popular and important companies within education technology. And again, BPS Tech and BPS endorses both of these curricula. We offered you some resources, and we told you about the importance of digital citizenship and whatnot. Now we want to give you some quick and easy tips on how to manage some of the more popular and more pervasive topics in digital citizenship and safety that are going around in schools, not just in BPS, but throughout the country, if not the world. So first one we're going to touch on is password security. Second is digital footprint, reputation, and cyberbullying. Third is copyright and ownership. And the fourth is phishing. So password security. So according to Microsoft, there are many ways in which you can approach formulating a password, and it's good to instill these ideas into students at a very young age, especially when they start to formulate and come up with their own passwords. First and foremost, don't ever write down your password on a sticky note and stick it somewhere, especially on your computer. That is the worst form of security, and someone will undoubtedly come along, pick up the password, and be able to access any type of sensitive information a student may have in his or her account. So it's important to instill this fact at a very young age, and that if you make passwords and put them on a sticky note and stick them in places, people will find them, and the security on any type of account could be compromised. Second is make sure that a password is at least 8 characters long. The longer the better. However, you don't want to make it so long that you can't remember it. But just remember, if you have an 8-character password versus a 11-character password, an 8-character password, if hacked, could be done in a matter of hours. With a password with 11 characters or 10 or 11 characters, could possibly take hundreds of years to hack. And that's one person, or that's companies hacking for 24/7 nonstop. So you can see that the difference in terms of password security and length when it comes to making a password and having it be secure. Make sure it doesn't contain a username or a real name or the school name. Make sure it doesn't contain a complete word and that it's spelled out completely in the same case. For example, Nick Gonzalez, that would not be a very good password. But if it was N1CK6 instead of G, that would be better. It's alphanumeric. Make sure when you make new passwords, they are significantly different from the previous passwords. And make sure that it contains uppercase, lowercase, numbers, and symbols in order to really make sure that your passwords are secure. Next is digital footprints, reputation, and cyberbullying. One thing to really remember is that the internet is written in ink, not pencil. And this was quoted in that famous movie, The Social Network. And one reason that why it's so important is, especially when it comes to students in high school and the juniors and seniors and whatnot, is that once you publish something on the internet, it doesn't go away. It can follow you. So this, you know, colleges look at social media websites and interact and Google names and whatnot. And if anything bad is written about you or if you have a negative reputation, schools and jobs can find out about this. So it's really important to convey the idea that when something is published on the internet, it's written in ink, not pencil. It is very difficult to erase. It is very difficult to delete. And sometimes it's almost, most of the time, it's almost impossible. So with that, we go on to cyberbullying, which is a very big issue in schools throughout the world right now, and some effective ways to combat some cyberbullying. Now, one thing you have to keep in mind when it comes to cyberbullying is that teachers are probably are the go-tos when in terms of mitigating cyberbullying. A lot of times, parents don't understand what to do, and so it's really important that teachers and educators understand some of the very basic techniques in combating cyberbullying and teaching it to their students. So the first one is screenshotting. Screenshotting, any type of harassment or any type of cyberbullying and storing it is a really effective way to stop and combat cyberbullying because you can, when you screenshot something, you take the picture, it loads onto the drive in your mobile device or onto your computer, and you can take it to an educator or administrator or a parent, and the student can say, look, this is what's happening to me. You can also do the same thing with screen recording, actually recording your screen using screencast or some of the screen recording apps that are available on mobile devices. You should also print it out as well. So once you get a screenshot or a screenshot, you can actually print out the picture or print out anything image that and actually have it on a hard piece of evidence. That's very important as well, that you need to always have that hard backup that you can use in case it's ever needed. And the last thing is to really encourage your students to tell educators, parents, and administrators that cyberbullying is happening, and that there's a way to combat it, and these are the effective ways you can do it: screenshotting and printing and recording. The next one is copyright and ownership, and the first thing I want to emphasize is what's called the DMCA Act, or the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, which is a copyright act that essentially says, you can't just go and steal people's stuff and use it as your own. And it's also on our BPS Acceptable Use Policy, AUP. It's, and a lot of students tend to think that if it's on the internet, it's free, and that's not necessarily the case. You can't just use everybody's work and everyone's images and make it as your own. It's not, again, digital ethics comes into play. Using other people's work as your own, again, it's almost like cheating. And so you have to find ways to mitigate this and show students that it's the correct behavior and the ethical way to copy or to use other people's things is to actually credit them. And there's ways you can go about this. There's Google Advanced Searches, where you can actually use stuff that's online where people have posted content and material that say that their material and their content can be used by anyone for free and with no copyright infringement whatsoever. But there are others that say you can't. So always be sure to use a Google search, advanced search, to find out this type of content if you want to use it. And if you do use it, it's always really good practice to cite what you use. Always give credit. So for example, if I take a picture and it's on Google and it says picture taken by Nick Gonzalez, it's good practice to, if you're going to use my work, and I say you can use my work, to use my picture and then credit me at the bottom for actually being my work. And this is also especially true for fair use. If you're going to use it for education, for the most part, a lot of the content and a lot of the images that are online can be used for free, but it's part of the fair use policy. So the last topic we'd like to hit on is phishing. Now, phishing is when bad people try to get sensitive info from users through fake emails, calls, and text messages. Sensitive information could be anything from an address to a phone number to a social security number to a credit card number. Now, this might affect a lot of our older students because some of them have credit cards, but a lot of our younger students are being targeted as well, especially when it comes to addresses and to phone numbers and to ID numbers. And so young adults are actually targeted by phishing scam artists as well. Now, there are many different types of phishing scams, and the ones that are used the most on young adults and kids are what's called whale phishing scams. And these are scams, these are emails that are sent out to millions of students at a time and ask for various sensitive information, especially like, for example, like ID numbers or in some cases social security numbers. And this is especially popular on Instagram and Twitter right now. And some are so well done that you can barely tell the difference between a regular post and a phishing post. So if we look at the Twitter post right here that Rihanna's gonna switch to, you can see this looks pretty legitimate. At Andrew Gerwood, have you heard of Google? Have you heard Google is hiring people to work from home? Pretty cool, I thought. And then you see http.dwarfedurl.com, 1F291. So again, this looks pretty legitimate, but in actuality, it's a phishing scam because Google will never use dwarfurl.com. They would probably use their own URL shortener, goo.gl. And again, they wouldn't go about hiring like this. Google is a very prestigious company and a very powerful company, and they don't do things like this. And so this is obviously a phishing scam, and if you were to enter your information, and if you enter your address or your phone number, a lot of sensitive information could now be bought and sold on the internet. So this is, again, a phishing scam right here on Twitter. Thank you so much for tuning in. It was great talking to you today about digital citizenship and safety. We hope you learned something. Again, these are some quick and easy tips. The digital citizenship is all the rage right now, and being safe online and understanding fake news and hackers and what can happen, and all the great things that are also available online to our students. Various resources and the world of information that's out there. So with all the positive stuff, there's negative stuff as well. Thank you so much for joining in, and we'll see you next time. Signing off. Thanks, everyone.